All right, welcome in. You are live with another Draft Rehab Show. I am Luke Polglaze, joined as always by my man, Eric Trickle. Eric, how are you doing tonight?
Doing pretty good. A little on the tire side, but good.
Yeah, so you got the whole new podcasting rig set up going there?
Yeah, I had a lot of fun setting it up last night. That's why I was asking about you, if you were busy.
Oh, I got you now. Yeah, those are fun to get to set up.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, we are back and we are ready to go with another Draft Rehab episode today. We're going to be talking about UConn safety Obi Melifonwu and Eastern Washington wide receiver Cooper Kupp. But to start with, I saw this floating around Twitter earlier today, and it has to be shown, which is fantastic. It's from at football players, which means that it's almost definitely stolen from somewhere else. But you know, it's still great. So I just like to take a moment and highlight this defensive back's press coverage here. Just rearing back and smacking him across the face.
Did it draw a flag?
I mean, it just gets better the more you see it. I think it did.
Look at the ref. The ref looks like he's going for it.
Yeah, or he could be signaling an offsides.
Yeah. It's so fantastic.
Yep. Like
that full rear arm all the way back and just smack right across the face.
Yep, exactly. So I figured we'd start with some UConn tape here. Do you want to start us off with some conversation points about Obi Melifonwu?
No.
What do you know of him?
Well, there's been quite a bit of talk about him. I know that he was drawing a lot more interest even heading into the Senior Bowl. And now that the Senior Bowl started, he has really shown very well so far. And he's just drawing even more attention. It's just... No. Sorry, I'm busy trying to do something else too. But,
yeah.
I think they're talking highly of him.
Yeah, I think the biggest part is his weigh-in, which, I mean, he clocked in at a 6'4", 219. I mean, when you're talking about safeties in the NFL, strong safeties in particular, this guy fits the mold.
Yes.
So I think he's big enough at that size to definitely survive in the box. So this is my first exposure to his tape. As always, I like to pretty much going fresh to these, so I'm going to be interested to see what he brings. So anything else?
I've seen some on Twitter, some people concerned with his coverage ability. I will say this, that NFL scouts have no concerns about that. The few scouts I've talked to, I should say. They have no concerns about his ability and coverage.
Great. Well, let's take a look.
He is the one with the arrow pointed at him, just in case you needed to know.
Appreciate that. So pretty much just playing robber back into cover two. You'll notice his back pedal there is a little bit different from the way most defensive backs are actually taught to back pedal. He has the stance right here. Is the back foot pretty much aligned, the toes aligned with the heel of the front. But most defensive backs are actually trained to step back with their back foot first. And you'll see he kind of just rocks on that and goes with the other foot. See, there's that rock,
yeah,
and then the other foot. So he really should be stepping back with the other foot on that play, which is just a little tweak in technique. So that snap looked wild enough that I think they had to abandon. It looked like an RPO inside one of the run pass options, because
yeah.
I mean, this snap is all the way out there. So the quarterback has to reach for it. I think he's probably going to be reading this guy right here on that play is what it looked like. So he has to abandon the motion to the running back and instead just throw the bubble. He's got numbers to the perimeter. I mean, one-on-one, 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 leaving the receiver on the free safety effectively. And you see Melifonwu here recognizes this, and he starts to come downhill here. It's a good job just closing in space.
Yeah.
Right there. Really like to see him bring him to the ground, but, you know, it's going to do the job. That's just a weak spot against quarters. You got cover four here, quarters from the defensive secondary. He's going to take quarter, and he's just going to settle in right behind the kind of the hook zone right here. Just settle and work outside where this guy isn't going to sink. And you'll see it right there. You know, that's a great route against that kind of coverage. And it forces Melifonwu to come up and make that tackle, which he does well. That's a good open field tackle.
Yeah, it is. That actually reminds me of a difference. Another scout I talked to, you talked about how he may be one of the best tacklers, if not the best, in the draft. He's getting a lot of praise for his tackling ability. I mean, he's not afraid to lay the put down the punishing hit, but he doesn't have to. There's a lot of safeties who rely on that big hit to make the tackle, but now he can take it. He'll do. You saw it earlier, the one where he just took him out of bounds but didn't take him to the ground. He's going to do just what is needed to bring the player with the ball to the ground.
And you'll notice right there how he's just so aggressive and just closes violently.
Yeah.
Again, you notice his back pedal. Again, he kind of just steps with that one and then goes back with the other foot. That's a good tackle.
Yes, it is. I saw one of the best comps for this guy on Twitter the other day. It absolutely is not even remotely close. And the only reason why I'm convinced they were compared is because they are both UConns.
Byron Jones?
Yes.
No way. Oh, yeah. I can tell from 40 seconds of watching this guy, he's not Byron Jones.
No, he isn't. Not even close. Nowhere near the athletic freak that Byron Jones was.
He can be a physical freak. You can talk about him that way, but he's not an athletic freak.
No. I mean, he's going to, from what I understand and from what I've seen of him, because I have seen a little bit of him before, is that he's going to test out very averagely at the combine, is the expectation. All the athletic measurements, it's going to be very average. He's just not – he's athletic, but he's not an athletic freak like Jones.
He's more of a football player than an athlete.
Yes, exactly.
I like him kind of angling there to cut off
the
receiver's lane. Doesn't need to blow him up. Just help get him down. A lot of quarters, a lot of cover two so far. just if you're taking notes on how he's being used. And again, this is one of those weak spots against quarters. You're giving up basically the flats because this cornerback is going to creep back, take away anything deep. So you'll notice him. He has to get over number two, the receiver here. Second receiver gets over him. And you'll notice when he sees him go flat, look at him already reacting.
I've noticed that a couple of times. He reacts very quickly. As soon as the quarterback locks on and starts his windup, he's normally breaking or in the process of breaking on the ball. He did that earlier on that broken read option pass earlier.
Mm-hmm.
He was, as soon as the quarterback stopped and was in his windup, he started to break. I see a lot of people talk about the quick reactions, quick mental breakdown of the play from linebackers. And I hardly ever see it for safeties. And I think it's actually bigger for safeties.
Yep. Especially when you're going to be playing, two, sure, but especially if it's in a cover four heavy scheme.
Yeah.
Because they're asked to do so much more. And now you notice this time, the defense's adjustment is that they're going to, when the offense goes with that motion across, they're going to counter with the man moving with him. So you see it's man with this safety rolling with him, giving them numbers on the bubble screen. And I really like how he fights off this block with his eyes on the ball carrier.
Yeah.
Doesn't get caught up in getting blocked.
And again, he was breaking on the ball before when the quarterback was doing his windup.
Yep. When does he break downhill? There.
And
What was that?
I was looking forward to a rep like that from him.
I mean, first of all, that is a horrible throw.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not talking about the throw or how the outcome. I just wanted to see him up playing press.
Mm-hmm. Well, and so he's got inside leverage here. But my issue with this is he just lets him, like, it's the whole shoulder and release thing from the receiver. He just gets his shoulder in. Right here, you see him just kind of put that shoulder into the chest and lean into this into the defensive back. And then he comes off it and looking for the ball right there.
Yeah.
Which is legal because you're not pushing off.
Yeah.
It's a technique that you teach to avoid pushing off. But that was just a dreadful throw.
Very bad.
But he's got to be more active in fighting around that. Those are the moments when you want your all 22.
Yeah.
What I like is, again, he's got outside leverage this time. And he sees it's a pick route right here. And he sees that pick coming, and look at him scoot around that right there. Mm-hmm. Good understanding. Robber dropping out.
Again, he's breaking when the quarterback's wind with the quarterback's wind up.
Yep. That's what you call, or what I've heard called, depends on your system, an offhand read. When the quarterback's offhand, his non-throwing hand, comes off the ball, that's when you break. Watch two hands. See the quarterback, two hands. Once that hand right there comes off, he breaks.
Yep. That's exactly what it is.
So that's smart football. He knows to read the quarterback's non-throwing shoulder. So his left shoulder here, he sees it come around. He floats around with it, sees it settle, watches that hand come off, and he breaks.
Yeah.
Just reading the quarterback. Some people are going to say that's anticipation. No, that's film work. That's coaching.
High football IQ.
Yeah, that's knowing your position. I'm interested by this. They're going to call that pass interference. Interesting. I mean, man, I used to be a DB's coach, but I don't know if I agree with that call. So again, he's in the back pedal, sees just a poor route from the receiver. Watch the receiver outside stem, and then just rounds it off.
I hate that.
So he breaks. Yeah, I can see that left hand getting in there a little bit.
Yeah.
But he's aggressive. He's playing the ball. Be curious to see a replay if we get one. Yep. It's a good aggressive play, but you gotta be careful with that hand. He's not really committing deep, which is interesting. I wonder kind of what's going on there, because in certain circumstances you're going to say, you know, that might be a product of the offense that he knows, or in this case, down in distance, or just, you know, that he's not prepared for that. But this receiver is coming hard right up the hashes. And again, he just sinks and goes outside. It's not a great route. But he did not commit at all to that deep route.
I really want to say that it was just a lot of film work. Just a lot of film study, learning this Virginia offense and kind of what they do. Because that would really help go with his reading of the quarterback, of being able to break on the ball and just all that study.
And you notice him just float over the hashes too. It's really nice. About 5 yards inside, just floats over it. Good Lord, what a horrendous spot. That was horrific. So he just floats back into the flats here. Not a great back pedal, just kind of a shuffle.
Yeah.
And how you spot this ball there Good grief. College refs, man. College refs.
Wait, they spotted it on
the... So ball's what? Caught here, 38.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's a 36. That's a horrible spot. Now this I'm going to be interested in. Money down, man coverage. He's a little bit ungainly in his back pedal. He kind of just chops his steps a little bit. See there? It's not as smooth, not as fluid as you'd like. You expect him to run with that receiver, not chase the run, so that's good. Kind of liked him. I'd really ideally like him to read the quarterback a bit better. I mean, he reads him well. So that's not what I should say. I should say read the field better, because this wide receiver has a step and he can float over that.
Yeah.
I know it's cover four, but that's a situation where you can just come out of your zone. That's just a bad angle.
Yes. I'd love to see the all 22 on that play.
Yeah, he took a long time getting there.
Yeah. I want to see how badly he bit on the fake play action.
Because he's coming from a long way inside.
Yes.
And he just kind of breaks on an angle instead of just chopping his feet and staying square in the open field, and he ends up outside him.
Yep. Good thing he had teammates.
Yep. This is another one of those situations. Sorry, go ahead.
I like what he did for the tackle. He's kind of brought himself to balance and then just did a form tackle there at the end.
Yeah, that's a good tackle. You know, as a defensive backs coach, for me watching film on a bubble screen, I have this internal clock where I should see the free safety appear on screen, and it is right about now.
Yep.
And he's not there. Breaks down, makes the tackle, but that internal clock is going off.
It's his not showing up when that internal clock for you goes off is a question of play discipline. How badly is he biting on those play actions? It's stuff that I speak about this often in articles I write of player discipline. There's a reason for it. And when you sit there and you see him take longer than it should for him to get there, you automatically have to think that, well, we can't see it now, that he's breaking too much on it and he's losing that discipline of keeping that backside pass.
Yep.
Sorry, there was more I was going to say, and it just kind of slipped out of my head.
I got you. This is an interesting coverage to me because this is they're basically playing man to the front side here. Because if you watch, like, they're not passing here. He's got the out and up. They're just running scissors on that side, and he ran with it. So obviously he knows what they're doing. Because that's just a weird coverage.
Yeah.
Holy run lane, Batman.
He did not bite on that play action at all there.
Nope. And look at how offset this line is. That was what I was noticing. Look at this gap.
Yeah. Oh, I see it.
You think they're going to pull right there? There's the pull.
Yep.
When you set an offensive lineman that far back off the line, you're just clearing space for him to pull around.
Yeah.
Boy, they should have handed this ball off.
Mm-hmm.
Different names for it, different places, but every team's going to have some variation of it on their playbook. Double slants. He recognizes it. He takes away the inside slant and throw it goes to the outside one.
Yeah, first time we watched it, I thought he was jumping on the wrong route, but no, he was just taking it away.
Yep. Oh, nice. There's your play discipline. They run the inside RPO look. Again, here's that look up front. There's that gap. They run this look often enough, they're going to get you with it. They're not handing this ball off anyway. They're running that bubble screen look to the trips with the number two bubbling, and it gets him to step down. Now he's reading bubble screen now. He's seen a variation on this play enough times, probably what, five times by now, four or five times they've run that. It's second quarter, late second quarter. So they're just getting him to step down. He steps down, tight end, just runs the seam. That was almost a big play. Look at him step down on that.
Yep.
Boom. Right into his vacated zone. That was almost a huge play. It wasn't staying disciplined. He was starting to imagine things. Not even imagine things. That's just...
He was jumping that bubble that they've utilized so often. Was expecting it again, and it hit him. Burnt him. Fortunately, looks like number 57 got his hands a little bit on the ball. Tipped it. And then who knows how the pass was after that.
Yeah. Now, if I was in an interview with him, you know, if I'm John Gruden, I'm putting this play up on and I'm going, now tell me what happened here, man. You got suckered in by that bubble, didn't ya?
Yeah, number 57 definitely gets his hands on that ball.
Yeah. You got caught looking, didn't you, man? Man, that was almost huge.
If he doesn't, they're at least to the 40-yard line, at least.
Yep. Line splits are closer. Great tackle.
Yep.
So many safeties missed that tackle coming out of college.
I've seen elite-level NFL safeties miss that tackle.
I mean, you've got a guy who you have right now is dead to rights, but by the time he catches the ball, he's going to be gone. So you have to aim for a target who's going to be moving upfield. And so many people, so many safeties just go too shallow, and they spin out down here. But he just aims center mass, uses his weight as a pendulum, just swings him around, got him.
Go back to pre-snap on this play, please. Nope, he never bit on the play action. That's discipline. And it's not only discipline, it's awareness of who he had crashing inside for to defend the run if it was there. So he just took the receiver on the outside.
I like this. He reads outside stretch, and he comes down and he just sorts through the trash. Look at him just come down untouched. That is a fantastic play.
By far his best play so far we've seen.
One of the few we've seen of him defending the run even.
Yeah.
Which you can make a pretty decent argument that a bubble screen is just an extension of the run game. But semantics.
Yes. Depends on who you ask.
True. Nobody gets a shot at him.
This is the angle I'm looking forward to, I hope. Yeah, there's some really good footwork there towards the end to avoid number 50 on the offensive line. Just watch the feet. Yeah, watch the feet just a little bit right about there. Just a little shuffle step to avoid the contact and then goes up, because if he just tried to run straight in there, number 50 is blocking him out of the play.
This is a weird formation. I don't think that's legal. That's a great tackle, and I'm very not sure that's legal. Yeah, that's not legal. Sorry, go on.
I really wish he actually finished the tackle.
You've got three guys in the backfield. This is not legal. One of these guys needs to be off. They both can't be on.
Yeah. Like it's, and here he didn't recognize it. He just stayed home and then came up after the ball was thrown, and then he doesn't finish the tackle.
Yeah, he engages in the tackle so well.
Yes.
great start, even lifts him off his feet.
Yeah, and just doesn't finish it. And he ends up joining back in, grabbing that foot to make sure he ain't going anywhere, which if you're on the ground like that and they broke your tackle, grab that foot. Just grab it. NFL defensive back coaches will tell you that. If they're still within reach, grab that foot.
Just yeah, and here he bails out over this one.
I truly got lost by this play.
That's nice. Don't give him a side. Don't give him that drill where the back goes one way or the other. Just stay right where you are and make him choose.
Yeah, it's nice, but I have issues with there. Well, no, never mind. My issue is that he could have met him with more force and avoided as much extra yardage that the running back, the ball carrier, picked up. But then I caught that another UConn player came up and hit him from behind.
Yep.
Giving him more momentum.
Ooh, free safety. Can he pick his way? Friendly fired his teammate.
Yeah.
Now this is incredibly hard for a free safety to read. You've got two verts very close to one another, and you have to get to the outside one. So he has to track and aim, and he gives up. He knows he's not going to beat the ball. Look at his helmet change.
Yeah.
His angle of his helmet. He's reading the ball. Ball, 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 ball. Right there, he knows he's not going to beat it. His head, eyes come down, separate, yep. And lays out his teammate.
Fortunately, never mind. Teammate's not okay. A little reckless, but at the same time, it's a football play. Things like that are going to happen. And it sucks, but it wasn't exactly a bad thing by him.
He's still running on that. He stays running all the way through. He knows his responsibility really well there. I mean, he's deepest of the deep right here. Like, he can't attack downhill as aggressively as he did on that one run play. This play, he's just got to stay back, make sure the play doesn't get past him.
Yeah.
Robber coverage comes up. Just collisions the tight end. You could say that's illegal contact. I wouldn't disagree. He sees the bubble. Look at him. Oh.
Man, I wish he would have broken out and covered the bubble more than he than pursuing the quarterback like he did.
No, try just get your hands up. Right there. Get your hands up and disrupt the pass.
Well, I mean, instead of coming in, just crash into the throwing lane. Try and make a play. That's what I was attempting to say.
Mm-hmm, that too. I mean, he's still downfield. Here he comes right there. That's good recovery speed. Still would have liked him to make a better play to start.
Agreed. Took him a little long to show up there.
Yeah, he got caught up in the quarterback's motion to the other side.
Yep, exactly.
FIB, formation in the boundary. Quarterback half roll. Ooh. Oof. This block, man. Number 33. I think it's him. Yeah, it's him. This kid right here. This block. He's like, I got you, bro. Here, I got you.
Jeez.
Watch again, watch again. Sit down. Free safety again. Doesn't have the range to get there. Or there. I mean, this one is hard. You're in too high. He has to get over the here. And then he has to get back over the top of that. That's just hard for him to do.
Yeah.
It's hard for any free safety to do, but he doesn't have that range. Curious who won that game.
I don't know, but I could have told you.
Who won?
UConn.
UConn did. There you go. Well, so thoughts so far?
He finished with 11 total tackles in that game. I could see it. Definitely. Free safety in college, not a free safety in the NFL.
I think that's a fair take.
He doesn't have the range as we saw there the last little bit. But he's got the physicalness that's needed for the strong side in the NFL. A little bit better in coverage than a lot of your typical modern day safeties, strong safeties. And there's going to be some issues with him crashing down against the run when he gets a blocker on him. There was one play that a run play might have been a screen where a blocker got on him and he was just – it may have been another game I watched, though.
Yeah, I didn't see anything like that in this one.
Might have been in the other game I watched.
Yeah, I don't really trust his his discipline to stay disciplined back in free safety, and I don't like his range.
Yeah.
I don't like the way he plays the ball coming into the receiver's hands. Like, he has to play the receiver, not the ball, because he doesn't have the range.
Yeah, you can get away with being a little bit more disciplined at strong safety than free.
Yeah, free, and he's got the dis into, yeah.
Your free safety is normally your last line of defense.
Mm-hmm. And I like how he plays in traffic.
Yes.
I think he has the size and the tackling ability to be a heck of a strong safety.
Agreed.
He's going to, some cover three team is going to just snap him up.
And while we're talking about this, let me pull it up. I haven't seen him in any big draft board like CBS or anything like that. I haven't seen him even anywhere near the top five.
Safeties?
Yes. Not just. I pulled up CBS. CBS has him as a number six strong safety.
Mm.
So if you imagine him being added into, and they're 144th overall prospect. Just saying.
Man, I'm going to take a guy like that round 3 to 4. Yeah, I am.
They have a fourth, fifth round grade. I've been seeing a lot of round two, day two talk.
Yeah, day two for sure, actually.
Mid round two to mid round three was the range I've been given. But he's a good football player, not an athlete, as we touched on the thing. And he's NFL strong safety.
Yeah, especially with his backpedal, with the technique just being wrong. You don't want him to have to backpedal. Just stick him at strong safety.
Yeah.
Let him read and react on those routes over the middle. Yeah, I agree. He can play on my team. He's a football player. Hello? I can't hear you.
When I moved my computer, I muted my mic.
Appreciate that.
Oh, yeah. But as I said when I was muted, he's a heck of a football player, and I would take him twice on Sundays.
Yep.
Any day of the week, twice on Sundays.
As they say. All right, on to Cooper Kupp, the Eastern Washington receiver.
While we're getting there, can I talk about O.J. Howard for a minute?
Please.
Okay. I am standing alone on O.J. Howard as not being a first-round prospect currently. He has been very impressive at the Senior Bowl, so he is moving up some. But he's not getting top 10 talk, and I still don't see it. He hasn't had a chance to really answer some of my concerns with him. I'm really looking forward to seeing his game. But there was one more thing that was brought to my attention today that I am rather curious about. Apparently, per a source of mine, he is not interviewing very well. A couple different scouts told me that when they brought up some of their concerns, mainly with his hands and effort with blocking, when the plays goes away from him, he got very defensive and then snide about it.
Interesting.
I think he can end up a top 20 pick, possibly even top 10. Right now, I just don't see it. I want to see more effort on blocks that when it goes away from him, more effort making into catches when they're contested, because people don't seem to realize that he's given up on a lot of passes thrown his way when they've been contested. That was one of the first things I noticed when I was watching over his film last year. And then, so I was just writing it off that it was him being younger. So, but I saw it even more this year.
Right.
One of these days we'll have to get to a draft rehab on O.J. Howard.
Would love to. I mean, I think the interesting thing is people are saying he's a top 10 pick as a tight end. The last tight end to go top 10 was Eric Ebron. Last tight end in the last, like, however many years was Eric Ebron.
I forgot he went top 10.
The Lions haven't.
I was thinking Vernon Davis.
Man.
That was the last one that came to my mind.
I'm not going that far back.
That's how long it had been. I completely forgot Eric Ebron, and then everyone else was – I just couldn't think of anybody. I'm older than Eric Ebron.
You're what?
I'm older than Eric Ebron, by the way.
Are you really?
I just found that out.
By looking at him right now?
Yes, yeah, so I pulled up his Wikipedia. He turns 24 in April. I have hit that point where NFL players are younger than me, and it's a little weird.
I'm hitting that point too now. It's weird, man.
It is very weird. I don't think people really get how weird it is until you get that stage.
Yeah, like not the youngsters, at least.
Yeah.
There you go. Vernon Davis was the last top 10 before Eric Ebron.
Ah. And Eric Ebron was number 10 overall, so that's why I forgot.
Prior to that was Kellen Winslow Jr.
Isn't he still officially technically in the NFL? Because I don't think he's ever actually officially retired.
I don't know. Last I heard, he was like trying to make a comeback last year.
Yeah, that's why I don't think he had. Yeah, just last March, he was trying to. He's an unsigned free agent still.
There you go. Hasn't played since 2013. Good luck, Kellen. Boy, these
33 years old. 33 years old, by the way.
Man, these early 2000s tight end drafts are fascinating. So many names I remember. Billy Bahama, like of
I'd
just
love
like
for you to put this on the screen so I could take a look at it.
Sure, I'll play along.
All right.
Billy Bahama.
Ben Watson, man, I love that guy.
He's a fun guy.
Yes.
Leonard Pope.
There we go. I remember this guy, Joe Klompfenstein.
Dude, that I unabashedly have Madden 2008. He is a stud for me in Madden 2008. I'm dead serious.
I always made sure I got Tony Scheffler, who is two names below him, by the way. I don't know why what it was, but I always loved Tony Scheffler, even though he was never really very good.
No, I remember when he went to the Lions and he wasn't good, and I was like, whoa, buddy.
Yeah.
Even at the Lions, man.
Gary Barnage.
Yeah, I was going to say, it always blows my mind that he's been in the league since 2008.
Yeah, I know. That's what it was threw me off for a second. I forgot about that.
Same as like Jacob Tammy.
Yep. Yeah. Or Michael Finley.
Yep. Fred Davis.
Bennett. Dustin Keller. That's a name I haven't heard in a long time. Whatever happened to him?
I think he got injured, didn't he? Like with the Dolphins. He was always good, dude. I think it was injured with the Dolphins in preseason.
Yeah, injuries have always been a killer for him.
Yep.
But yeah, he was lost with the Dolphins. Let's see.
Pasco.
His first 4 years, he played all 16 games.
Yeah, it was that one ACL that just shredded his knee.
Yeah. After 8 games. And he was having a good year before that, too. In 8 games, he had 28 receptions for 317 yards and 2 touchdowns. That's actually not bad.
Yeah.
For 8 games.
Dude, this 2010 tight end draft is not talked about enough. Jermaine Gresham, Rob Gronkowski, Ed Dixon, Tony Moiaki, Jimmy Graham, Aaron Hernandez, Dennis Pitta, Garrett Graham. Yeah, right. I was trying to skip that one.
Hooman. Oh, I always loved him.
Hooman, Corliss. A lot of guys still in the NFL from that draft.
Yeah. Isn't Anthony McCoy still around too?
I have no idea.
Unless I'm thinking of somebody else. I'm pretty sure he started this year. I'm pretty sure. Unless I might be thinking of somebody else, but he's probably a free agent. I must be thinking of somebody else.
Man, this draft is pretty great too. 2013. Tyler Eifert, Zach Ertz. Vance McDonald, Travis Kelce, Jordan Reed. Luke Wilson.
Toy Lolo.
Michael Rivera.
I'm pretty sure he's a free agent. I wouldn't mind picking him up.
Rivera? Yeah, I like him. Man, we are just down tight end memory lane right now, aren't we?
Fido!
Nick O'Leary.
Fido.
Did you know that his grandfather was Jack Nicklaus?
Yeah.
It's crazy, man. I feel like that isn't mentioned enough.
Go back down to 2014. Fido is probably, let's see, looking at this. Oh, no, Jordan Reed. No, wrong year. Hey. Fido was my top tight end that year, just saying. Followed by Crockett Gilmore.
Yeah, I love me some Gilmore.
Same. But Jason Morrow, Austin Seferian Jenkins, Troy Nicklaus.
That was a weird draft for tight ends.
It was. I remember it was. Everybody said that it was one of the weakest, and it really was. It wasn't a strong class at all.
Nope.
Nothing like this year's.
No, not at all.
We really do need to have just a tight end day now.
We do. I would be totally on board with this. Dear Lord, 19 tight ends drafted in 2015.
What?
That's kind of shocking to me, honestly.
No. Looking at this, no, yeah, it makes sense. I mean, so
many like 5, 6, 7 guys, but still, I wouldn't have said, if you held a gun to my head, I wouldn't have said 19 guys is what I'm trying to say here.
Oh, I wouldn't have said 19, but I probably would have said about at least 15. Once I remembered who's some of those who are in it, Max Williams, Wolford, like, oh yeah, I remember that year.
Yeah, that's a fun year.
Nick Boyle, Tarzan like Jane. I remember talking to you about him.
Yeah, I remember him. Still getting suspended.
Couple of Broncos on this list. Just saying. It's Ben Koyak.
Ben Koyak, I was going to say. Big dude.
I like him. He's another guy I'm older than.
Mm-hmm.
Just say, okay, when was Eric Ebron drafted? He was drafted in 2014. Koyak is literally a day older than him.
That's crazy.
April 9th to April 10th.
Benefits of coming out early.
Yeah.
On to Cup?
Yeah, before we get carried away.
Too late.
That carried ship, away more than we are?
I know, that ship has sailed.
I now just kind of want to do Billy Brown from Shepherd. Kidding. Somewhat.
No, you're not.
I said somewhat. I like Billy Brown, by the way, from Shepherd. It's going to be a tight end in the NFL.
What is he in college? I'm not familiar.
Hmm.
Another one of those Georgia Tech guys from a couple years ago?
Oh, yeah. Hold on, let me pull up.
He's Darren Waller.
He actually... has made some big plays for the Ravens.
Yeah, he developed well.
He's not consistent, but.
So, thoughts on Cup?
I actually have seen very little of him before. But Billy Brown is 6'4", 241, real quick.
He was a receiver in college?
Yep. He put up 99 catches for 1,580 yards and 22 touchdowns. And he had one kick return for 2 yards.
The heavy lifting.
But some of these games, 7 for 97, 9 for 129, 9 for 209. Of course, level of competition here. You're talking about Glenville State, Concord, teams like that. But 12 for 193 against Assumption College.
11 for Shepherd, right?
Yeah.
Hmm. Cool. You ready to move on to Cooper?
Yeah.
All right.
I've heard a lot of interesting takes on him, but I haven't watched him, so I can't really speak to how those takes are.
I've also heard takes, but not watched him. This is from his game against Washington State, although obviously this is a highlight reel right here.
Highlight reel scouting. 101.
Worst kind of scouting.
No. Second worst. Box score scouting is the worst.
I can get on board with that. Can you get sizes for Cooper Kupp real quick?
6 foot two, 195 pounds. I just pulled it up.
Cool.
Tall and skinny. That seems to be the case for a lot of these guys who are like 6'1", 6'2". They're really skinny this year.
Well, I've heard it's the same like with like Robbie Anderson last year out of Temple. He was like 6'1" and like 180. Like he was mad small. I heard this interesting theory that like, or not theory, it was like a statistical analysis thing. I can't remember where, but it was like so many seventh round wide receivers are like 6'1", 195.
That's a good portion of this year's draft class for receivers in general.
Yep.
Big receivers, I think, are going to get a little bit drafted earlier, a little reached on, because it's not very many.
Punches.
Is he still around?
Yeah, he's in Carolina.
Still? He didn't, you know, fumble himself out of there?
Kelvin Benjamin is.
I will say, Kelvin Benjamin, it has kind of proved me wrong a little bit. He has done better than I thought he would.
He was horrible this year, man.
Yeah, he still has done better than I thought he would.
I mean, same, but... Oh, so one of my favorite stories is Kelvin Benjamin. He comes into the league, and he petitions the NFL because he wants to wear his college number, which is a single digit, and, you know, you as a receiver, you can't.
Reggie Bush did the same.
Yeah. And so he comes in, and I believe Von Miller did too. He wanted to wear his 40. And so he comes in and he says, you know, hey, I want to wear my single digit number one in the NFL. And the NFL is like, A, no. And B, your quarterback, Cam Newton, already has that number. I don't think he's going to give it up.
I don't think he could pay Cam Newton enough to give that up.
Yeah, and that'd be a lot.
Talking about sizes of receivers, listen to this. I mean, you have your top two, most people's consensus top two, Mike Williams and Corey Davis, both 6'3", 225, and 213. Then your CBS is next three because it's the one that's most handy for this. John Ross, Curtis Samuel, and D.D. Westbrook, all 5'11", 190, 200, 175. Juju Smith-Schuster is a big guy. But then you have Adarius Stewart, 6'0", 204. Coop. I already mentioned earlier. Malachi Dupree from LSU and 6'2", 190. Isaiah Ford, 6'1", 190. Zay Jones, 6'2", 202. Chris Godwin, 6'1", 205. And then you go down a little bit farther, skipping like two receivers. 5'11", 5'10", 6'1", 6'1", 5'11", all of them in the 190s. Low 190s, high 180s. Like, this is the year for tall, skinny guys.
Yep.
Except for Ryan Switzer, who I love.
Yep. You know what's crazy is, to me, Curtis Samuel is probably a top five wide receiver and running back.
I actually worked on my position rankings, and I think I put him as a top five receiver.
Man, give me that guy. We need to do him, please.
He actually is. He's my number five receiver.
Where do you come in running backs?
I didn't put him as running back.
He would be top five, though, right?
No, I'd probably have him at six.
Behind?
Dalvin Cook, Fournette, Kamara, Williams, and McCaffrey.
Joe Williams?
Jamal Williams.
I was trolling. Surprised you have him that low.
People anyway. Didn't call me crazy for this. About Williams being top five and possibly going in the second round. But when it happens, I'm going to be Frog and D.
Okay.
I hope you heard that.
Back to this film.
Yes.
So, okay, so this block, I really would have liked him get his hands inside a bit more and actually leverage instead of just throw a shoulder.
Yeah. A little lazy on the route running.
Yeah, what? You know, that was way more than a little.
Understatement of the year.
He's running. It looks like just like a hook. But he rounds it off.
Yeah. You want to be crisp with those kind of routes.
Yeah, because the most important part of those routes is that the quarterback knows where you are and he puts it on that spot.
Yeah. To be fair, though, that ball never should have been thrown to him. Just to be fair.
I can get on board with that take.
Because the linebacker was literally right in front of him.
I don't know why most teams don't use this more often. Just basically an underneath, like, drag route on first down. Just use that as your check down. You got him running across the field.
It's a good way to pick up 3 to 6 yards, at least.
Another lazy route.
This is fitting with one of the things I've heard about him, lazy routes.
That's completely poor block. Engage right there. Drive him. Just lets him run around a bit. Oops, there he goes. Damn it. My bad.
He's a little bit more crisper when he has the ball.
I don't know. I don't like his read right here. Just
no, it was a bad read.
Bend this further inside. What is he doing?
Yeah.
Hit the hashes right here. That's just a poor read of his blocker. Just read the side of the helmets. You know, if your blocker's helmet is inside the defender, then you're going inside. If he's outside the defender, then you're going outside him. I mean, this helmet.
Back, I'm ripping him to shreds over a couple things on this.
Yeah. I mean, that helmet is all the way inside.
Ended up being a good play, but doesn't mean it was sloppy.
RPOs, man.
Touchdown.
Again, it's a sloppy route.
It was. And it was even sloppy after the catch. It just kind of lets the defender get his hands on him. I would have liked to have seen him put his arm out for more of a stiff arm.
Yep, right here you're just RPOing off the linebackers. Those two linebackers right here, they both step up against the run. And quarterback just pulls that ball and throws it in behind him. This route is just abysmal.
It is. But here, he just kind of lets him in. Like, throw that arm out. Keep some distance. And then the devil's advocates out there will argue that he does that, you risk an arm tackle. Which you do. But letting him into the body like that, you risk being tackled anyways.
Here's going to be a good view of the route. Yeah, he just rounds it off.
Mm-hmm. See, he puts his arm out there early, and then he doesn't do it again until he actually puts his hands on him to break free. This actually reminds me of a story of when I was in college, or not college, when I was in high school playing.
Do tell.
I was a linebacker, mostly rushing. So I didn't drop into coverage very much. Hardly ever. But I dropped back into coverage, and I allowed the catch because I got...
Suck.
Well, yeah, I sucked in coverage. I wasn't very good. That's why I didn't cover much. Anyways, I allowed the catch. The guy goes, I end up recovering and going to make the tackle. I miss. Then a teammate of mine, he goes to make it. He gets stiff-armed into the ground. And the coach, our receivers, or our defensive backs coach, sat there and started chewing him out about it. All you had to do was get your hands on him. That's all you had to do. Just chewing him out about that. Just because you get your hands on him, as we saw with that Coop play, doesn't guarantee that you bring him down. That's what reminded me of it.
Good take.
Yeah. Very lazy routes.
Yeah, and with that, you know, you've got a matchup on a linebacker. Just trust your speed, man. Like, no need to stick your arm out right here. Just run away from him. He's a linebacker.
Yeah. Very slow linebacker at that.
No kidding.
Plays for Eastern Washington or Western Washington, whichever one.
Washington State.
Oh, that's Washington State. Oops.
Sorry, Washington.
Too many colleges out there. I don't know them all.
Free safety just bit all the way down. He's wide open. My goodness.
Would you like to hear one comparison of him that I've heard?
Very much so.
Jarvis Landry.
No.
Yes.
I disagree.
Oh, I hate that. I hate that comparison. I hate it. And I've always been a Jarvis Landry truther. Always.
I mean, same, but fam, let's talk about this catch.
Yeah. Jeez, insane catch. There's the Jarvis Landry comparisons.
Yep. Nice move right there to get the cornerback to reset his feet. Getting interfered with, in my opinion, touchdown. Ooh, buddy. I still hate the fade route, but that's a great play.
Yeah. I'm off Googling something real quick. I'm out.
That short dig route again. RPO. Boom. Oh. It was tipped by that linebacker. Sure, glad we got to see that play. Hopefully get a replay of it here.
Yes, because I missed the last few plays as I was Googling something. Been trying to find something.
Oh, the cameraman completely missed the play.
Oh. Oh, joy.
Yeah, because of this.
He put up 117 catches. Or 170 catches for 1,700 yards and 17 touchdowns.
Production.
Yep.
The cameraman focused on that instead of the ball.
So, he played in 2014. They played Washington. He matched up on either Marcus Peters or Sidney Jones all game long. He put up 8 catches for 145 yards and 3 touchdowns on those two. So level of competition shouldn't be a question with him. Those are one first-round talent and one second-round talent, depending on, obviously we'll find out where, and he smoked them.
Again, it's just rounded off routes, but he's aggressive at the catch point. I don't like that. I don't like this play one bit. Watch him run his route to the guy. Nah, yeah. You gotta make space, create space for yourself. He's got his eyes on him and he just runs it. He just cuts it into him. Part of that's the throw, but you got also clear space for your quarterback.
Yeah.
Oh, man, nice catch.
Whoa. I want to see that from a different angle.
Yeah, really he bad. Got up there for that.
Yeah, I just want to see that vert.
Perfect angle.
That's impressive.
Get up there, big fella. Man.
In the NFL, he's getting creamed.
Yeah, that's a horrible throw.
So far, he's not super impressive, but not.
He does his job.
Yeah. There's a lot to like and there's a lot to dislike about it. That's why I can really understand the wide range of takes on him.
Mm-hmm.
A lot to like, a lot to dislike. I really wish he was more crisp with his route running. Really, really wish that. Because unless you're a big-bodied receiver, I mean, to be honest, at 200 pounds at, 6'2", there's no excuse for him not having crisp routes. If you're a little bit bigger, then, yeah, you can kind of use that size as a little bit of an excuse for it.
Yep. Now, I wanted to pull this game in because it's a snow game and it's because it's the playoffs quarterfinals here, so figured it's a good enough one.
Yeah.
Both pretty short against Richmond. I really appreciate just how aggressive he is after the catch.
Yes. No issues there. Biggest issue I've seen so far is aggressiveness as a blocker and route running.
That's a good block.
Right on cue.
Yep. Finally made one.
But as I tell everybody, one play doesn't make it. Consistency.
And that's a good route. What have we done?
He hurt us. We have angered him.
Well, that wasn't a great route.
No.
He doesn't have a great route tree either. He's not asked to do a whole lot.
Yeah.
Lots of like stops and sits and hitches and
a lot of his routes are routes that are designed to create separation with the route. The few times where it hasn't been due to the route or the type of route, he hasn't been really impressing me with how much separation he's getting.
Look at the stands. I wouldn't be out for that either. There you go. That's a pretty impressive number.
Very much so.
He's the Pumphrey of the receiving corps.
Don't want to talk about tiny lit dudes. Talk about him.
Yeah. Fade route. Oh, man. Ran the post, and he had him, too. Get the block. Oh, man.
What was that?
It was a dreadful throw.
Awful. Horrible decision, horrible throw. Everything about this is horrible. Like, he had time and he just rushed it and for no reason. God. Bad quarterbacking. Love this. I love this.
From the quarterback or receiver?
Coop. Play breaks down. He keeps active. He keeps up. He keeps with his quarterback to make an easier throw. So he's not having to throw across his body.
Yep. Give him a target.
Yep.
This scramble drill.
Yep. Exactly. There's two teams in the NFL that do this often because of what happens with their quarterback. Both of them made the playoffs. Both of them made their championship games respectively. Aaron Rodgers and Big Ben. You see this happen a lot with Green Bay and Pittsburgh. They break free. You stay with them. Give them a target.
You know, honestly, who I'm getting like real team vibes for from him?
Who?
He feels like he is a very Buccaneers receiver. A guy they just need to come in, play, you know, the Z across from Mike Evans. Just go out and catch balls and get yardage. They like those smaller guys, too.
Yeah. With their 2-6-3 receivers.
Who's the other?
Vincent Jackson.
Man, is he still even there? He doesn't count at this point.
Pretty sure he had a pretty good year this year, last year, too. Oh, he's 6'5". Holy cow. Oh, no, he must have got hurt or something. He only played in five games. Oh, no, he's been hurt the last couple of years. played in 15 games between 2 years. There's obviously some very, very, very big differences between the two players. But how he is, route running and overall speed, obviously are the going to be the two big things here. Is he reminds me some of Jordy Nelson. Just with...
Because he's white?
No. How they are with the scramble drills. How he was with gate breaking free, staying with the quarterback. And then the toughness after the catch. That's the Jordy Nelson comparison, start and end. Those two things. That's what reminds me a little bit of Jordy Nelson. Not
it could be, you know, Jared Aberderis or Jeff Janis at this rate, you know, man.
But no, I am starting to see some of the Jarvis Landry comparison as well. That one play with the big vert is a big example. Or I shouldn't say I can see it. I can see why it's being given. Has he dropped any passes? Like really badly dropped?
Like really badly? No.
Yeah. Like, because I remember seeing one drop, but it wasn't a bad, bad drop.
And like, I don't know. He hasn't been touched is my thing. Like he hasn't been pressed. He hasn't been touched, like collided off the line. Like he hasn't been touched.
Yeah.
He's be curious to see that. I mean, because he runs, you know, up the seam unchecked.
I'm with you. I really want to see him pressed. I don't want to see him keep seeing him be allowed to run free.
Because, I mean, look at this. He just runs away.
Yeah. He's going to be challenged a lot more in the NFL. So you want to see that kind of stuff in college.
Because, I mean, he's just running. Like, he doesn't even get touched right here. Defensive back has the baseball turn. Nothing.
Yeah.
Come on.
Definitely not a blocker.
No, this kills me. He's got his eyes inside. Look at that. Just looking away. Come on, man. Concentrate, focus, drive him. Do your job.
From what I've seen, another thing that was told to me, I'm just not seeing. I was told he was a little too overactive. Too many jukes, too many fakes, things like that in his routes. And I haven't really seen that.
No, they've been smooth. They've been like lazy and rounded off, but smooth. Now, this one, I will say I don't like his release off the line. This is not smooth. He's got what I call the giddy up step. But there.
Oh, yeah.
The kid out of Mississippi State last year. What was his name?
Mississippi State last year.
Tall receiver, number one, dreads, former basketball player.
I know who you're talking about, but I can't think of his name right now. I'm going to pull up
he would do that same giddy up step every play. Just accelerate off the line. Well, I like this one, though. He's running a different route. We haven't seen that kind of short out route from him yet.
D'Ronna Wilson?
Yep, D'Ronna Wilson.
He went undrafted.
Yeah, nobody ever signed him.
Really?
Yeah. Got a tryout with the Saints, was it?
He was with the Chicago Bears practice squad in October for a little while.
I didn't know that.
Probably won't ever play in the NFL. Has some legal issues going on right now.
Oh, makes sense.
Did he really just go fight with his teammate for the ball?
Yeah, it was poorly run. You missed it. They were in the same spot.
Oy.
Now you can either say that that's selfish or that's a my ball mentality.
Yeah, that would be an interesting talk. Was it my ball mentality or was it selfish?
Yeah.
What I think is that he needed to be a little bit more aware. So did his teammate. You know, like call it or bat, you know, that baseball with the bat and the ball. The baseball pop fly. Two guys going for it, calling for the ball. Like, granted, NFL's a little bit more fast paced, so it's harder to do, but.
Yep. Well, thoughts on him?
I can see the positive talk about him that's getting him talked as a second round pick. But I can also see the negative talk that's getting him talked as a fifth or sixth round pick. I'm very mad on him personally. I'd probably put him as a third round pick.
I'm early day three from that.
Fourth round pick, yeah.
Yeah.
I'd put him late day two, early day three, probably.
I don't know. Like, I don't feel like there's a whole lot you can build on. Like, he's so open most of the time because nobody's going to check him. Like, I haven't seen how he physically responds to that. Based on his blocking, I'm not super encouraged. Yeah, I mean, most of the time he's just wide open down the seam.
His grade would definitely reflect on other games watched.
Yeah,
it's
I agree.
It's hard to do when you don't see something as big of an aspect for a position like that. It's like watching defensive linemen who get pulled against the pass. Like, you can't really see what they're going to do against the pass.
Mm-hmm.
And that often leads to them being as run down defenders only. But there was a guy a few years back who got labeled that. And while he's not a fantastic pass rusher, he does well.
Yep.
Or Jadeveon Clowney. He got, I don't know how many times I heard that he can't defend the run, and he's not the best run defender, but he's solid at it for the Texans.
Yep, I agree.
I really want to see that, but I do think that there is a place for him on a team as like a three or four receiver based off of what we've seen.
Mm-hmm.
There's ways you can design plays to get him the ball and let him do work after the catch. That's really a big reason why I would go with that late day two, early day three grade on him.
Yep, exactly. I think you can involve him in your offense, but I wouldn't necessarily build him into your offense, yeah, per se.
But yeah, he's One thing that I think is going to be a knock on him more than ever, more than other people realize, is the whole size thing. If you are, we had this a few years ago. We had littler receivers go faster because they were stuck with a bunch of big receivers. This year, it's a bunch of littler guys, not super little, and the big guys are few and far between. And I think that's going to hurt his stock a little bit, that he's hasn't really separated himself from these little guys and doesn't have the size to stand out either.
Yep, I agree with that.
That's one thing I think that often gets overlooked, by the way.
Hmm.
Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five receivers, 6'3" or taller. 1, 2, 4 of them are over 210 pounds. And two of them are at 213.
Hmm.
Oh, I shouldn't even count him. I don't consider him a receiver.
Billy Brown?
No. Evan Engram.
Engram. I was going to say Engram.
There's a lot of concerns about him, by the way. Hand size.
Yep, I've heard them.
Yeah. Getting a lot of good information from this, from the Senior Bowl week.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Your boy, Colorado quarterback, Sefo. I'm not going to try to say his last name.
Lufau.
Lufau?
Mm-hmm.
I guess he's interviewing really well. I won't be surprised if he doesn't get taken with a seventh-round pick.
I think he'll get drafted. I don't think he's going to really have a shot in the NFL. I think he might start a game at some point in his career, but I don't think he's going to do particularly well. I think he's got a lot that you can build with, but I don't think he's a starting caliber quarterback by any means.
Yeah. But just going over these Senior Bowl rosters real quick. Sometime we really should try and get a little bit of time before the Senior Bowl and talk about these rosters. But Jalen Robinette, he is a guy who I have been told repeatedly, over and over and over again, that he is going to go way earlier than anybody thinks.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not thinking round one, obviously. Not thinking round two. But I'm really feeling that early round three.
Interesting.
I've watched some of him. Really impressive. Uses his size extremely well. But he's another one of those guys. He's a bigger receiver, 6'4", 215 at the Senior Bowl. And he uses his size.
Man, move Obi from safety to wide receiver. You got something going.
But yeah, there's a lot of guys at the Senior Bowl who are standing out, and I'm sitting here just smiling away because these are all guys I really like. I haven't talked about them much on Twitter. I've been on Twitter a lot, but I haven't been talking the draft a lot. But guys like Jordan Morgan from Kutztown, the offensive guard, he's doing really well. Taylor Moton from Western Michigan, he's doing really well. Julian Davenport is impressing with his smarts and interviews, though he is a little bit lackluster on the field right now. Kyle Callis from Michigan, he is one of the better technicians in the draft, and he's really impressing. Dan Feeney, he stood out today. Dude's a beast when the pads are on. Pads came on.
He's beast.
Beasting. Deion Dawkins, he's had his ups and downs, but he's impressing a lot. Let's see, Derek Rivers and Larry Ogunjoboy. Ogunjobi.
I don't know. I have no idea. I'm making this up.
I'm not sure. But from the defensive lineman from Charlotte and Rivers, the linebacker from Youngstown, they're both impressing. They're both sleeper guys that I have. There was another one that I want to talk about, but I think he's on the South team. Real quick. Oh, Nathan Peterman, he's a quarterback on the North team. He's one of my top quarterbacks, like, in a weak class, granted. But he's standing out really well.
It's a weak class. It's a really weak class.
In a stronger class, he's probably looking at a fifth or sixth round grade, but I think he can develop into a very solid backup.
He reminds me of a guy who's going to slip like a. Who was the Arkansas guy last year? Harris? Brandon Harris?
Oh no, must oh, Brandon Allen?
Allen, that's right, Brandon Allen. Reminds me of him, like in just terms of his prospect.
Yeah.
Allen went in like the seventh round.
Something like that. No.
I know he's a Jag.
Thought he was number
Jaguar,
one,
not just a
yeah.
guy.
Sixth round.
Sixth round, close enough.
6'1", 217. I thought for sure Denver would take him because he fits the thing there. He fit Kubiak's system perfectly, but obviously Paxton Lynch.
Obviously.
Jamal Williams, he's really turning heads. I just gotta mention that. He's my boy.
All right. Well, while you continue to just ladle out praise for yourself, I'm going to start wrapping this up. All
All right, man.
right. You can follow Eric on Twitter at Eric Trickle. You can follow me on
Eric
Twitter.
Trickle.
What?
At Eric Trickle. ERICK. There's both the C and the K, just saying.
You can follow me on Twitter at Luke Polglase. Check us out on Twitter. Make sure to subscribe. We'll definitely have more videos coming down the pipeline as we go into the off season. And yeah, keep up the great work
I'm
out
already
there.
starting to tweet out my draft take, so if you're interested in the draft, now's the time to follow.
And promptly unfollow it in May.
Yes.
For
For
Eric.
the bad Star Wars takes, promptly unfollow.
For Eric, I am Luke. We will see you next time.
Have a good night.